Thus, Emperor Bhakti. the effect of transcendental knowledge in this particular verse. Yadrucha Lava Santushto. A devotee is satisfied with whatever comes of its own accord. A devotee knows that in this material world, so-called happiness and distress is already predestined for every living being. So he doesn't endeavor for increasing his happiness, material happiness, and avoiding misery. In this world, all the conditioned souls are busy in these two things, trying to increase their material happiness and avoid misery. These two things are going on. But a devotee who is called Brahmabhuta, he is always prasanna atma. A devotee is always prasanna because he is connected with the Lord. Brahmabhuta prasanna atma. Na shochati na kamsha. A devotee has nothing to lament in this world. If he tries for something, for the pleasure of the Lord, if he works for on a project, and if he doesn't get that result, he does not lament. He did his duty perfectly according to his means provided by the Lord. And if the desired result doesn't come, he doesn't lament. But an ordinary man who is not Krishna conscious, he works hard to achieve some material gain, and when the desired result doesn't come, he becomes fully frustrated in life. He feels great pain. So this is the difference between a devotee and a non-devotee. A devotee also works hard, non-devotee also works hard. Sometimes people think devotees are all lazy people. They're escaping from their duties. They're telling that you all have given up your family, you're all in some spiritual organization, throughout the day what do you do? You don't do any work, but you see us, we're all working so hard. But actually a devotee works more than a non-devotee. Because the responsibility of a devotee is very grave. What is the responsibility of a devotee? A devotee has taken the responsibility of delivering Krishna consciousness to all the forgotten souls in this material world and to awaken one soul who is conditioned, who has forgotten Krishna, who is in full ignorance, is not at all easy. A devotee spends his whole life. Prabhupada writes in the purport of Bhagavad Gita that even if, in the preface, he writes, even if one soul becomes Krishna conscious, even if one person becomes Krishna conscious, he feels my endeavor has achieved perfection. In that old age, when he was 70, Srila Prabhupada went to America, some foreign land, unknown place. And there he went to some low class people with their coral drunkards and meat eaters and doing all sinful activities, lived among them. He is coming from a very good family. Srila Prabhupada, he had his own business, he had his own family, he had all comforts. He sacrificed all those things. Why? Because his guru, his spiritual master, had given him an order. Prabhupada wrote one letter to his spiritual master before his spiritual master passed away from this world. Just before that, he had written a letter. My dear Guru Maharaj, you have many sannyasi disciples who are always serving you in your organization. And I am a householder. I could not be with you and I could not render much service to you. Please tell me, how can I serve you? That way, Srila Prabhupada had written a letter. And his Guru Maharaj had replied, he told, my dear boy, you please preach Krishna consciousness in English language, and those who listen to you, they will be benefited and it will benefit you also. So in that way, that was the essence of the reply given to Srila Prabhupada. So Srila Prabhupada took that order very seriously, that my Guru Maharaj wants me to preach this message of Bhagavad Gita in English language. Because in this material world presently, people imitate the Westerners. They think Westerners have advanced a lot. What is that so-called advancement? How to eat nicely, how to make nicely, how to defend nicely. They have advanced in sense enjoyment. So people think, those who are ignorant of what is the reality, they think if you have big skyscraper buildings and if you can freely enjoy these things, that is advancement. But this is not at all advancement. It is same eating, sleeping, mating, depending, wherever you may go, without shame, in the streets, not elbowing. Earlier, this was regulated, eating, sleeping, mating, depending, especially illicit sex. That was all regulated in Vedic culture. But now the advancement made is they are openly doing in the streets, in the public. This is their advancement. So, it is not at all advancement. Because people are imitating the Westerners, Srila Prabhupada's Guru, Bhaktisiddhanta Satsitankur, told Prabhupada that you write this message in English language. So that when the Englishers, who are leading the whole world, the Westerners are now the leaders of the whole world, when they take to Krishna consciousness, then the entire world will follow them. So that was the plan. So Srila Prabhupada, he translated the books into English language. It's all in Sanskrit and Bengali. So he wrote translations, and for every translation he wrote purports, the meanings, how it can be applied in our day-to-day lives. He gave all the explanations. And then he was waiting for an opportunity to go to the Western world. And in India, first of all, Prabhupada tried to establish this movement in India, and there was no encouragement. And then, somehow with the help of one lady, he got a free ticket to New York, America. And he went there alone. With just 40 rupees in his hand, he didn't have anything. He took his books and he went. Great struggle. And there for 1 year he tried preaching in different places. Still there also people were not interested. They were all absorbed in their materialistic endeavors. And then slowly he saw that some youngsters, he went to one park actually, and he started doing Kirtan, Hare Krishna Kirtan. And those younger generation during that time, they were all frustrated with this materialistic life. They are not at all happy. The so-called advancement is their pain. So they were all lying there in the bar with, you know, drinking and drugs and illicit sex. They were all lying here and there. When they saw that here is a sadhu doing kirtan, let us go. So they all went near him and they joined the Hare Krishna kirtan. And then Prabhupada told them, come to my classes, attend the Bhagavad Gita classes. And slowly some sincere souls started coming. And then slowly they started understanding what is the aim of life. Aim of life is not to advance materially. Aim of life is to advance spiritually. Aim of life is to know who am I, who is God, and how to overcome the sufferings. So Srila Prabhupada explained to them what is the importance of human life. So that is explained by Lord Krishna here, that those who are wanting to advance spiritually, they have to be satisfied with whatever comes on its own account. This is an instruction for everyone. If at all we have to be happy, we have to be satisfied with whatever comes by the will of the Lord, based on our own karmas. Every living being is different, every human being is different. In his bodily features, you see, no two human beings is equal. Isn't it? Everyone's beauty is different. That is based on karma. Some are born in rich families, some are born in middle class families, some are born in poor families. So their wealth is also different. Some are very intelligent, extremely intelligent. Some are okay, average students. Some are always dull. That is also fixed. How much ever you beat the child, it will not become intelligent now. Sometimes parents become upset. Our child is not all getting more marks. So threaten and beat and send for extra tuitions and do whatever you may like. But that's karma. You cannot do much. So Krishna is telling, based on karma, material happiness and distress is fixed. Within that you should learn to live. Yatrucha labha santushto. But at the same time, we have a duty to perform. The main duty of human life is to advance spiritually. So one should be thoughtful in human life. So associate with devotees. Learn from them what is life. How to improve in our life spiritually. Spiritual progress is not restricted by material constraints. Even a uneducated, poor man also can become Krishna conscious. And very rich, aristocratic king also can become Krishna conscious. So Krishna consciousness is open to every human being. Krishna consciousness is not difficult, very easy. Krishna consciousness means knowing that I am eternal part and parcel of the Supreme Lord Krishna. I am eternal servant of the Lord. And my duty is to render service to Him eternally. That is my relation with the Lord. What is my actual relation with the Lord? That will be revealed to me as I progress in Krishna consciousness. So I need a spiritual master who can guide me to understand my relation with Krishna. So therefore, to advance spiritually, first of all, one has to surrender to a spiritual master and then receive directions from him. How to disassociate ourselves from this material energy, this body is covering the soul. It always makes us forget who am I. This body is an energy of the Lord, divine energy. It's very powerful. So, we can know that I am not this body only under the direction of a spiritual master when we cultivate transcendental knowledge. So, it requires certain austerities, it requires certain regulations to be followed in life. Without that, it's not easy to understand who I am and who is God. So, some regulations are given here by Krishna. Samaha Siddhava Siddhavcha and then Dvandva Tito Vimansaraha. Krishna is telling that one should be free from duality and should not envy, because a Krishna conscious person knows every living being is part of God. Every living, anything that moves, any living being, it can be an ant or an insect or a mosquito or a animal or a reptile or a butterfly or human being, birds, 84 lakh species and innumerable living beings. So Krishna is telling you should not be envious of anyone. Generally in the material world, we are envious of others who are more advanced materially. If someone has more wealth than me, I become envious of him. Someone is more beautiful than me, will become envious of him. Someone is more intelligent than me, will become envious. So Krishna says, one should be vimansaraha, one should not be envious of others. Because whatever material pleasures one experiences in this life is sanctioned by the Lord as per the law of karma made by the Lord. Every living being has performed certain amount of papa karma and certain amount of punya karma in his past lives. So based on that, the Lord observes every living being. Karmana daiva netrena. The Lord is observing every living being and every living being's actions. And he keeps a record of it. Karmana daiva netrena. Because the Lord is there in the heart of every living being, He is a constant companion of every living being in this world. desires of the living beings. And based on the actions they perform, especially this papa and punya, it is applicable only to human beings. In lower forms, papa and punya is not applicable. Because in lower forms, the living beings are fully under the control of material nature. Their urges, bodily urges, everything is fixed. They're eating, they're sleeping, they're mating, they're defending. Everything is fixed by nature. They have no choice. So there is no question of papa or punya for the souls for interacting lower forms of life, like animals, birds, and plants and trees. Papa and punya is applicable only to human beings. Human form of life is that body, this human body, where every part of the body, every sense, the five jnanendriyas and karmendriyas are fully developed. Mind and intelligence is fully developed to think what is right, what is wrong. We can go beyond the thinking, feeling, willing of animals. Animals also have certain intelligence, but that is limited only to fulfill their material demands of eating, sleeping, making, depending, that much only. Like Prabhupada gives an example, when he was giving lecture in Vrindavan once, he saw that one monkey entered into the kitchen. In the kitchen there was a bunch of bananas kept. So people are all busy hearing the lecture, attentively they are hearing Prabhupada's lecture. But monkey is not attentive there. Monkey doesn't know what is going on here, what is this Guru Maharaj is speaking. Monkey is busy finding out where is food. So monkey, that too it's outside somewhere on the branch of a tree. Its eyes are so sharp, especially nose. In lower forms, nose is very sharp. They can smell where is food. What is favorable, what is unfavorable, very quickly they can make out. So the monkey, so quickly it entered through the window, within a fraction of a second, it snatched some bananas and ran away. So that intelligence is there in every living being. A cat also knows where you are kept well, very easily it can find out. Slowly it goes without making any noise. And slowly it will drink and run away. So like that, this type of intelligence is there in every living being. How to protect its own young ones? Every animal knows. If you see a hen, when it's raising its chickens, small chickens, all the chickens will be together and they'll be eating some things. And the hen is very, you know, alert. If it sees a kite or eagle in the sky, immediately it spreads its wings and makes some sound, which the chickens will understand that there is some danger. And all the chickens will come within the body and she will cover. So, how to defend, how to get food, how to mate, how to eat, all these things are already there. That intelligence is already provided by nature to everybody. If you see, when a creeper, you know, in a jungle, so many plants keep growing. So, every creeper, it needs certain amount of sunlight for it to grow. So, the creeper adjusts itself to somehow receive its required quota of sunlight. Or if you suppose there is a tree and if you start constructing some building, the tree adjusts itself to somehow get its required amount of light. So that intelligence is there even within the tree. How to get its required food? Somehow it sustains. So this type of intelligence is already there in every living being. But advanced intelligence to know who am I, why am I in this material world, why are sufferings inflicted on me, even though I don't want sufferings, why are they coming, how to get out of sufferings, these type of advanced knowledge or inquiry, jijnasa, is possible only in human form of life. That's why Vedanta Sutra says, Athato Brahma Jijnasa. Now that you have got human form of life, Sai, now it is your duty to utilize your intelligence to understand yourself, to understand the Supreme Lord, and put an end to the sufferings in this world. So for that, some instructions are given here by Lord Krishna in this verse, especially he's telling, you should not work hard to make improvements or advancements in material enjoyment, because these things are already fixed for a human being based on his past karma. My duty is fixed, I cannot change it now. What's the use? Isn't it? Why should I worry so much about my duty? Already knows I am, how it should be done, fixed structure, isn't it? Some people take it so, not some, many of them. Oh, some plastic surgery they have to do, then somehow want to make some part of the body little swollen, or so they want to change their nose, or some other part of the body, they want to change the color of the skin. They spend crores of rupees on that, full of worries and anxieties. Little fat they become, they want to make their body thin, so go to the gym. If they are thin, they want to make their body little more fatter. If they are too fat also problem, too thin also problem. So much worried about the body. And any time any disease can come, there is no guarantee, isn't it? Recently some virus has attacked.
Ebola.
Ebola virus. And that's a big news. Because every time new virus keep coming and attacking, they don't have medicine for that. And now they have treated one patient somehow successfully. They found out some medicine. And that's a big news. Now they have found out something. So this is going on. How Maya has diverted the energies, human intelligence especially. It requires intelligence, isn't it, to find out medicine and somehow cure it. So all the energy, all the time, the intelligence which is advanced in human life is getting diverted just for bodily pleasures. We have to take care of the body, it's not that we have to neglect the body. So Krishna is telling, you eat as much as needed to keep the body fit and fine. Don't indulge too much in sense gratification and forget the goal of life. There is a difference between need and gratification. Need means eat nutritious food given by God, especially vegetarian food. That is recommended by Krishna as sattvika ahara. You can offer that to the Lord and then take prasada, purified food. It purifies the body, it purifies the mind. We get good intelligence and good direction when we eat prasada, which is offered to the Lord. Gratification means we are not at all satisfied with what God has given. Okay, let me go to this restaurant today. Tomorrow we'll go there. After tomorrow we'll go somewhere else. So hankering. This is called sense gratification. Because the senses are never satisfied. It is called kama, lust. Lust is not, lust burns like a blazing fire. Into a blazing fire, if you pour drops of ghee, it will continue to blaze. It will not be satisfied. In the same way, if we try to increase the sensual pleasures more and more, the senses will dictate. Tell is not good, try something else. Every sense will dictate. Tongue will dictate, go somewhere, it will make you eat everywhere and anywhere. Anything and everything, without consideration. It makes a person fool. And ears want to hear melodious music. So try this song, try that album, buy this CD. Increase the CD, go on increasing the CD day after day, you know, cupboard is full of CDs. No song will satisfy the ear. But for a devotee, he hears only one mantra, Hare Krishna mantra, same tune, whole life, no need of increasing CDs. So this is the difference between material song and spiritual song. In our temple, we play only one Hare Krishna mantra. Throughout the day, 12 hours or 24 hours a day, we play only one song. And every time we hear, we like to sing that. We don't change it. Why? Because it satisfies the soul directly. But the so-called music, which is played not for the pleasure of the Lord, but for the sake of pleasing the ear, it doesn't satisfy the soul. Therefore, we have to go on, we have to keep releasing newer and newer music and newer and newer CDs. Especially in Mysore, many music concerts keep going on. More and newer and newer, you know, then all that fusion, classical and western, they're trying so many ways to satisfy the soul. They're not satisfied with classical. They want western now. They're not satisfied with western, so things go on now. This is going on. Why? Because so-called material music that doesn't satisfy the soul. Unless we satisfy Krishna, we cannot satisfy ourselves independently. So we have to be vimatsaraha. We should not be envious of other living beings. If they possess something more than we materially, we should understand that every living being has got his so-called material assets based on his own karma. So let him enjoy. Why should I envy him? So that should be the mode. Vimatsaraha. And samaha siddhava siddha ucha. Samaha, we have to be equal in happiness and distress. We have to work honestly with whatever acquired nature we have. According to our nature, we have to choose a job. Without working, we cannot keep quiet. That's the law of nature in human life. Everyone should work to maintain his body. Now, what type of work should I do? Some people are confused. They artificially try to take up work of someone else. That's not the way. One has to take up a job which is natural for him. Acquired nature or swabhava. Swabhava means if that is normal for him, he can easily do it and he is satisfied with it. That one can make out his own swabhava, to be revealed to him. What is my swabhava? Based on the intelligence, what I have got, based on the nature, based on the inclination, what I have got, I should take up that kind of job. And we should not feel that I am inferior or he is superior. Everyone should do his work based on his swabhava. So, the Krishna is called Chaturvarnya Maya Srishtam Guna Karma Vibhagasha. There are four divisions in human society based on the acquired nature and the work one does. Those who are predominantly in the mode of goodness, they are called Brahmanas and they have their duties to perform. Brahmana's duty is Yajana, Yajana, Patana, Patana, Dana, Pratigraha. Those who are predominantly in the mode of goodness, they have to perform sacrifices to please the Lord and engage all other people in performing sacrifices to the Lord. Yajana yajana, patana patana. They have to study the Vedic scriptures, understand the instructions given in the Vedic scriptures and teach them to others for their benefit. Patana patana, dana pratigraha. They have to receive charity from others. They themselves have to lead a simple life. They don't earn lots of money. They don't go for work because they are busy in cultivating spiritual life. So they receive charity from others who are working. They maintain a simple life and use the extra money for worshipping the Lord. Dana and pratigraha. Just like we are conducting this Akshaya Patra program, we receive donation, utilize it, we offer food to the Lord and give back to the people. To the needy people, we feed them prasadam. That's one way. Or we construct big temples. For whom? It is for people to come, have darshan, hear about God, become purified, hear bhajan, kirtan, honor prasadam. So, it is for the benefit of people. So, Brahmanas are those people who are predominantly in the mode of goodness. They have their duties to perform for the welfare of the society. They themselves have to elevate spiritually by practicing the rules and regulations given in the scriptures, and it is their responsibility to guide the entire human society to advance spiritually. Then there are Kshatriyas. Kshatriyas are those people who are predominantly in the mode of passion. Not by birth. Brahmana is also not by birth. It is guna karma vibhavashaha. If someone has taken birth in a Brahmana's family, he may become a Brahmana by training. But it's not necessary. Just like if someone has taken birth in an engineer's family, the child may become an engineer if he likes to. His father is an engineer, his father may train him up. He also has to undergo the training of an engineer. He has to get admitted to an engineering college himself and he has to learn. Once he successfully completes the degree, then he is an engineer. The same way, just by taking birth in a Brahmana's family does not make me a Brahmana. I also should acquire the qualifications of Brahmana by training. What are the qualifications of a Brahmana? Shamo, Dhamma, Tapa, Shaucham, Shanti, Rajam, Mevacha, Jnana, Vijnana, Mastikyam, Brahma, Karma, Svabhavajam. So that's explained by Krishna. A Brahmana means he has to be expert in controlling his mind, controlling his senses. He should be honest, he should be truthful, he should be clean. He should be well versed in scriptures. And he should know how to apply those instructions in his own life practically. So these are all the qualifications of a Brahmana. Unless one acquires these qualifications, he cannot be called a Brahmana. Just like unless one undergoes training in an engineering college and passes all the exams and receives the degree, he cannot be called an engineer. In the same way, unless one has these qualities, he cannot be called a Brahmana, even though he has taken birth in a Brahmana's family. Kshatriya is also a person who has undergone a training and he has his prescribed duties. Shauryo tejo dhritir dakshyam yudhe chaapya palayanam danam ishvara bhavascha kshatram karma svabhavajan. Heroism. He should be first in the battle. When there is fight, he will be first leading. He is resourceful. He gives protection to the surrendered souls. He is very expert in protecting the citizens. So Kshatriya's duty is to give protection to the citizens from thieves and rogues and plunderers and enemies. And see to it that every citizen is employed based on his acquired nature. There should be no unemployment at all. No one should be unemployed. Everyone should have his job to do. And it's the duty of the Kshatriya to see that everyone is doing his duty according to his guna and karma. At the same time, he has to, Kshatriyas have to give the welfare facilities for the public, building roads and all other required things, parks, sanitary facility, water facility, and whatever is needed for people in general. It's their duty to provide. And primarily, they have to build temples because they hold treasure of the state. They have to invest their wealth in building temples where people can come together and advance spiritually. So, Kshatriya is also called Naradeva. He is the representative of God. And he is having the responsibility to protect the citizens, fulfill all their material necessities and encourage them to advance in Krishna consciousness. And Kshatriyas are guided by the Brahmanas because Brahmanas know what is right, what is wrong. They are well versed in the scriptures. So Brahmanas give advice to the Kshatriyas in how to rule. So therefore Brahmanas are called the head of the society. Kshatriyas are called the arms of the society. They protect the citizens. And the production class, the Vaishyas, they are predominantly in the mixed mode of passion and ignorance. For them, the swabhava, the duties are krishi, goraksha and vanijya. The vaishyas, they have to produce good grains, protect cows and perform some business with whatever they produced, like jewelry and so many other business they have, vanijya, trade. So these are the duties of a vaishya. He primarily produces food grains. He feeds the entire society with food grains, fruits, vegetables, food grains. And vaishyas specifically have to give protection to animals. Kshatriyas, their duty is to give protection to human beings, citizens. Vaishya's duty is, apart from producing food grains, he has to give protection to animals and especially cows. Because cow is considered to be the mother, one of the mothers. For a human being, there are seven mothers. So, the seven mothers is, first of all, my mother, from whose womb we have taken birth, our own mother. Then, Brahmani, wife of a Brahmana, is also our mother. Brahmana is the father of the society. So, Brahmana's wife is also mother. Rajatatni, king is also father of the state. So, queen is the mother of the state. Rajatatni. Dhatri, Dhatri is a nurse. When a baby is born, there is one nurse who always takes care of the baby along with the mother. So, nurse is also mother. Then, Dhenu, cow. Cow gives milk and the baby drinks milk of the cow. So, cow is also mother. And then, Bhumi, mother earth. Earth supplies the food grains for us to eat. So, these are the seven mothers. So, we cannot kill our mother. Mother should always be respected. This is Vedic culture. But nowadays, being influenced by ignorance, being influenced by Westerners, Indians have built highly sophisticated, mechanized machines to kill cows. This is destruction of civilization. When cows are not protected, when Brahminical culture is not protected, the Supreme Lord Krishna is not pleased. And when Krishna is not pleased, then we can expect all sorts of difficulties. So, if we have to be happy while living, if we have to get our food, which is the basic necessity of life, we have to protect cows. And bulls are the father of mankind. Bulls help in tilling the land. Cows gives milk. So, cow and bull are also father and mother of human beings. They have to be protected. They should not be killed. Those who are meat eaters, those who want to eat meat under any condition, they may kill some lower animals like a goat or a chicken. But cows should never be killed. This is Vedic culture. And it is the duty of Vaishyas, it is the duty of the mercantile class of people to give protection to the cows. But unfortunately, present day, we see that cows are slaughtered in thousands and thousands. I see when I come from Bangalore to Mysore, I keep traveling. I see the trucks there, they keep carrying cows, two, three together. And I see many vehicles, not just one or two. Many vehicles are carrying cows every day and slaughtering cows. So this is the destruction of human society because of disobeying the instructions of the Supreme Lord. So one has to awaken. If at all we have to be happy, happiness is not by so-called material advancement, industrialization, and opening more factories, that's not going to produce cow's milk and grains. Cow's milk and grains produced by Mother Earth here. Mother Earth produces grains and cow produces milk. By killing cows, from where you get milk? Without milk, you cannot have a sharp brain. Our intelligence will become dull if you don't have cow's milk. So instead of drinking milk, they drink liquor and wine and that and this and opening more and more bars. This is going on. This is not civilization. Civilization should see to it that human beings are advancing spiritually, becoming more and more cultured, not more and more vulgar and wild like animals. We should not become animals. We should become more and more fine, refined people. Culture means fineness in everything. Without harming others, without giving pain to others, having the supreme goal of getting liberation, all our activities should be centered around that one single goal. At the end of my life, I should be able to remember the Supreme Lord and give up this body and no more enter into one more body. This is the goal of human life. No more suffering. No more next birth in this material world. Ante Narayana Smritihi. At the time of death, I should be able to remember the Supreme Lord. So, if we indulge in sinful activities, of meat eating, intoxication, illicit sex and gambling, how can we remember the Supreme Lord at the time of death? So it is the duty of the leaders to have this master plan that every citizen gets an opportunity to remember the Supreme Lord. For that sake, cows have to be protected, agricultural fields have to be protected, more and more agricultural food grains have to be produced. But because of westernization, more and more cities are developing, and what is happening in the city? More and more factories, all the villagers are leaving their villages and going away. They don't want to cultivate anymore. Who will produce food grains if everyone goes away? So that the rates will increase, definitely. And poor people, they'll not get any grains to eat. So they'll start eating animals. So this is all reaction. So we should, that's the duty of the leaders, they have to plan. So that planning is given by the Supreme Lord. We don't have to use our imperfect brain. Human brain is imperfect, limited. Supreme Lord's brain is perfect. Supreme Lord's direction is perfect. So our duty is just to follow the direction given by the Supreme Lord, because He is the Creator, He knows what is good, He knows what is bad. We cannot apply our imperfect intelligence and think, oh, we can start killing cows now. So clearly Krishna is telling, Krishi, Goraksha, Vanijya. When Krishna, the Supreme Lord, has told, you protect cows, it is the duty of every human being to do that. We cannot violate the laws of God and still live happily. And the fourth order are the Shudras. Paricharyatmakam karma Shudrasyapi svabhavajam. Shudras are those people who cannot do their own business. They are neither Kshatriyas, they are neither Brahmanas, they are not intelligent. They are less intelligent people, they have physical labor, so they have to work for the three upper class by physical labor. Either they do some construction work or some agricultural field work, whatever work. They should always be under the direction and guidance of the upper three class. So these are the four orders of life, social orders. So one should understand what is his svabhava and do duties accordingly. But in Kali Yuga, mostly everyone is a Shudra, no need of any confusion. Kalau Shudra Sambhavaha. But by training, one can become a Brahmana. Just like by training, one can become an engineer, one can become a doctor, one can become anything, any work he can do by training. So it's not that I have taken birth as a Shudra, I am Shudra, so I will remain a Shudra. That's not the Vedic culture. Vedic culture wants to make everyone a Brahmana. Brahmana is not a monopoly of one caste. That this caste people only are Brahmanas and everyone else are not. So, Vedic culture is open. You practice, you will also become Brahmana. So for that we need direction, we need guidance. So Krishna consciousness is open to everyone. Krishna consciousness is beyond Brahmanism. To directly know that Krishna is Supreme Lord, I am part of Him, my duty is to serve Him. A Brahmana can serve Krishna, Kshatriya can serve Krishna, Vaishya can serve Krishna, Shudra also can serve Krishna. So Krishna consciousness is beyond the Vedic rules and regulations also. So it's a duty of the leaders of the society to organize in this way. It is very difficult now to organize the society into the four orders which was described. Now, however it's going on, it's going on. Real Kshatriyas are not ruling the state. Few Vaishyas are there, greedy Vaishyas. They take advantage of Shudras, innocent Shudras. You know, they black market and dark market, you know, the brokering and some things they do. So few Vaishyas are flourishing. And those who are in the political post, they are not really Kshatriyas. They are all Shudras only, elected by less intelligent people. So they do all sorts of, you know, scams and scandals and this kind of thing. They don't know how to rule the society. And there are no Brahmanas at all who can guide the state. They are not powerful because the so-called Kshatriyas do not listen. Even though if there are some Brahmanas to guide, the so-called Kshatriyas are not Kshatriyas. They don't want to listen to the advice given. No, they say this is all mythology. You cannot accept this. This is the fallen condition of our state. And the solution for this is only one. There's only one solution. This question was asked by the sages. After Krishna left this world, under whose hand has Dharma gone? Because unless the Supreme Lord gives protection, we are all like scattered children, just like, you know, uncared animals. If the animals are not cared for, then wild animals will go and attack them. In that same way, innocent people, if they are not properly directed by Brahmanas and protected by Kshatriyas, they will be misdirected. So, what is the solution? The solution is only one. That is this Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita. If every day if we read Bhagavad Gita, every day if we hear Bhagavatam, then we are protected. If you do not give oral reception, if you do not hear Bhagavatam, the messages of Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita is ABCD of spiritual life. First of all, we have to understand Bhagavad Gita. And then advanced instructions are there in Bhagavatam, elaborate explanations. So, in human life, even in our present condition, in whatever condition one may be, if we simply every day spend at least 1 hour, simply read these books written by Prabhupada, this message is given in Bhagavad Gita, not ordinary messages. Then parampara jnana coming from Krishna. In Guru Parampara it's coming, these messages are not ordinary. So, if you simply read Bhagavad Gita every day, we will get the directions. Just by reading, we'll become purified. All the bad karmas because of which we are suffering in this material world will get destroyed just by reading. So every day we have to read Bhagavad Gita, and not Bhagavad Gita written by anyone and everyone. Only this Bhagavad Gita written by Prabhupada. Prabhupada says, I am the only authority in this entire world who can give the true knowledge of Bhagavad Gita, because I have not polluted the theme of Bhagavad Gita. Many people, in the name of writing Bhagavad Gita, they have given misinterpretations to the instructions given by Krishna. They show their so-called scholarliness and misdirect the readers in a different way. If it is told surrender to Krishna, Krishna is telling Sarva dharmān parityajya māmekam sharanam praja. Krishna is telling, abandon all varieties of religion, just surrender unto me. The so-called scholars misdirect the readers. They say it's not for Krishna, it's for someone else inside Krishna. So they misdirect the reader from Krishna. Krishna is telling, Mattaha Paratram Nanya Kimchi Dasti Dhananjaya. Krishna is telling, other than me, there is nothing else in this creation. I am the Supreme. Everything comes from me. Clearly Krishna is telling. And the so-called scholars, they misdirect the readers. So, those few who are interested even in understanding the Vedic culture by reading books, should not read those books written by unauthorized people who have simply interpreted in the wrong way. The message of God is coming in parampara. Not simply, it's not, anyone cannot become a guru. Just like we cannot become an engineer on our own, sitting at home. We have to go to an authorized college where there are teachers authorized by the university. They teach us and train us. Then we can become authorized engineer. In the same way, if I have to know science of God, we have to go to authorized teacher who knows science of God. Just by because I know Sanskrit language does not make me an authorized person to teach the science of God. Science of God begins from God Himself. Krishna Himself, the original Guru, He has explained what is material life, what is spiritual life, how one can become liberated. Everything is explained by Krishna. He has passed down to His disciples. So Krishna passed down this message to four disciples. Brahma, Lakshmi, the Kumaras and Lord Shiva. They are the four disciples of Lord Krishna. They have the message of science of God. And they have further given that message to their disciples. So there are four paramparas. From Lakshmi, the parampara is Sri Sampradaya, in which the prominent acharya is Sri Ramanujacharya. From Kumaras is the Kumara Sampradaya, where the prominent acharya is Nimbaraka Acharya. And from Rudra, from Lord Shiva, there is a parampara called Rudra Sampradaya, the prominent acharya is Vishnu Swami. From Lord Brahma is the Brahma Sampradaya, and the prominent acharya is Srila Madhva Acharya. And our Prabhupada, our Guru, is coming in the Brahma Madhva Gaudiya Sampradaya. So, if at all we have to learn science of God, we have to go to any one of these four schools which teach science of God. But innocent people, they don't know that science of God has to be learned in one of the four paramparas only. And they go to some bogus organizations. There are innumerable bogus organizations crept in Kali Yuga, and they are telling you, come to us, we will teach what is God. How you can teach? You are not connected to the parampara, how can you teach? So in this way, we can see there is so much deviation. Even the innocent people who are desiring to know about God also are being cheated by bogus organizations, and they are not able to make out what is right, what is wrong. It's only in our organization where Srila Prabhupada has so nicely explained, so clearly explained what is life and how one should lead a human form of life so that he can become perfect by the end of life. So Krishna is telling, in order to become perfect, one has to be satisfied with whatever comes on its own accord. One should not be envious, one should be equal both in happiness and distress. In this way, when we work, we will not be bound again to material loss and we will be eligible for liberation. So I'll stop here. Grantharshana Bhagavad Gita Ki Jai.